Joining us today for his take on Asian markets, Ken Wong of Eastspring Investments. Hi, Ken. Good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
Morning.
All right, so some analysts are calling it a stealth bear market, at least in the U.S. What can provide a decent hedge to one's equity portfolio now that growth seems to be at risk?
Yeah, the fact is that, you know, growth stocks have had its, you know, sort of weakening momentum, you know, for the past few months. And particularly, you know, when we look at, you know, sort of Asian equity markets, China equity markets, growth stocks have actually started to underperform since November. So, you know, this isn't anything new in which growth stocks have been underperforming. But the fact is that, you know, we're right now quite mindful as to looking for opportunities. And in particular, when we're looking at growth stocks, you know, now there's a lot of growth stocks which are trading now substantially below their intrinsic value. Looking for those growth stocks with good cash flows, good positive free cash flow generating. And those will be, you know, quality companies which we feel will come out of this, you know, in much better shape.
But when you look beyond growth stocks, though, Ken, when you look at growth in general, growth of economies, do you think that it's time to reprice our expectations of growth, considering the risks of higher inflation and tighter monetary policy that could actually choke some of that reopening growth that we're seeing?
Yeah, I think the markets have already priced in, you know, some of that potential in terms of slower economic growth for 2022. And, you know, slightly weaker earnings growth as well being priced in, especially given the high oil prices as well as commodity prices. So specifically in regards to whether or not markets have already priced in, you know, potentially weaker than expected growth as compared to earlier this year, we feel that, you know, the markets have already priced in some of that potential, you know, sort of downside.
Morgan Stanley said in a paper yesterday or the last 2 days, they're saying that the Federal Reserve, the fears over the rate hike has been overpriced at this point versus being underpriced 6 months ago. Do you agree?
Yeah, I mean, the fact is that when you look at it, we're pretty much certain that, you know, we're getting a 25 basis point rate rise later this week. And then we also know that, you know, sort of by looking at the end of this year and looking at how the Fed Fund futures are being priced, we're probably still looking at about 1 to 1.25% rise in regards to the overall Fed fund rates. And so specifically, a lot of that is already been priced in. But the fact is that given some of the uncertainty that we've been seeing with geopolitical tensions in Europe, and then specifically, you know, with rising oil prices, rising commodity prices, weaker than potential expected growth, there's a lot of people now who are a bit concerned whether or not, you know, that significant rise in interest rates will actually, you know, deter from economic growth weakening even further. You know, there's even been talks of potentially, you know, stagflation, you know, happening. We don't see that as a base case scenario, but again, you know, there's a lot of these talks and a lot of these rumors and jitters in the markets, and that's, you know, got some of the investors a bit spooked as well.
Mm-hmm. So Ken, when central banks start hiking rates, and the U.S. is going to start this month, of course, some Asian economies have started ahead, like South Korea, for example. Do you think central banks can engineer a soft landing? I mean, at the end of the day, even if it's just 25 basis point rate hike, it's going to mean more expensive money for everyone.
It does, but you also have to see specifically which particular country you're talking about, right? We know for a fact that, you know, U.S. is normalizing their monetary policies. But then when you look at across the pond and when you look at China, China is actually in a situation where they might actually lower interest rates further, given the fact that inflationary pressures is not high at all in places like China, you know, and even in some of the other markets where inflationary pressures is nowhere compared to what we're seeing in the U.S., there is actually further room for some of the central banks to potentially, you know, stay their course when it comes to monetary policies, or potentially even lower interest rates if needed.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned China, Ken. UBS also just upgrading China to most preferred stocks precisely because of, you know, the consensus that its central bank is going to stay the course or even loosen monetary policy, and the fact that it appears to be standing shoulder to shoulder with Russia. Do you think China is a safe haven at this point, despite, of course, the outbreak of COVID cases that caused manufacturing cities like Shenzhen to shut down?
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a crystal ball to tell you whether or not, you know, China is going to be specifically the, you know, sort of the key safe haven. But the fact is that when you look at where we are, you know, Chinese equity markets have underperformed over the past 15 months. Mm-hmm. We know for a fact that specifically when you look at valuations, Chinese equity markets are trading at, you know, 50% discount as compared to, you know, developed markets. We know for a fact that earnings remains fairly robust. We know specifically that economic growth for this year is still going to come in roughly between 4 to 5% for China. So when you factor in all these things, and when you factor in specifically how heavily oversold the markets have been, especially over the past few weeks, given a lot of these uncertainty, there is a lot to like specifically within the Chinese equity markets, in particular, you know, the Chinese Asia markets. We think that the domestic driven, you know, sort of stock market in China is somewhat, you know, it's somewhat less exposed towards some of these geopolitical or, you know, external pressures. And hence, you know, the corrections that we've seen within the domestic market is definitely, you know, opportunities when it comes to, you know, sort of investors who are trying to look for, you know, stocks trading below their intrinsic value or trying to bottom fish.
Ken, what about the Philippines? The PSE index is now flat year to date. It's like the last 3 months never happened. Are you inclined to change your market call on the Philippines?
Well, again, when you look at the Philippine equity markets relative to the other markets here in Asia, you know, they've mostly outperformed, right? When you look at the ASEAN markets as a whole, we look at Singapore, we look at Malaysia, you know, we look at Indonesia, we look at Philippines, you know, these markets have outperformed versus, you know, North Asian stock markets. I think when you look at specifically what's happening right now, you know, the concerns obviously is rising oil prices and specifically rising commodity prices as well. Because the fact is that we know for a fact that, you know, Philippines is an importer of commodities, or net importer of commodities. Specifically, these could potentially have an impact on inflation. As we saw back in 2018, you know, inflations do, you know, have a negative effect in regards to stock markets. So when we look at the Philippines, especially if, you know, where the reopening is going to be delayed slightly because of a lot of these other things which are going on, and then specifically if inflationary pressures do come back, you know, much quicker than anticipated, then you got to be a bit more selective. You know, in 2018, what particular types of stocks did well in the Philippines equity markets, in particular, you know, in higher inflationary periods? It was specifically conglomerates. It was banks, you know, so you have to be a bit more selective as to the type of stocks that you should be invested in or overweight in within the Philippines. But as a whole, you know, valuations are still very much attractive. And the other thing I think that's going for our Philippines right now is the consensus earnings growth for 2020 for this year, as well as 2023, because, you know, Philippines, if you look at the region, does have some of the highest consensus earnings growth versus some of the other Asian countries.
Mm-hmm. So Ken, what's going to be the strategy when investing in the Philippines? Should we go defensive and go short?
Well, in the market where, you know, things are a bit more volatile, you know, a lot of times investors do look to be a bit more defensive, to be specifically a bit more lower beta, as I mentioned earlier. Mm-hmm. You know, in a higher inflationary pressure environment, then, you know, investors might be more focused on, you know, conglomerates as well as the banks, mm-hmm. like what they did in 2018. So, you know, these might be the sectors to look at. But again, you know, when you look at some of the potentials there, especially with the potential for reopening of, you know, sort of the markets, more mobility within the Philippines, that's also going to do a lot of good for a lot of the consumer stocks as well going forward. So, you know, right now, you know, be a bit more mindful as to what's going on with the geopolitical uncertainty mm-hmm. and inflationary pressures. But then with the reopening and with more mobility that you can expect for, you know, a lot of the consumer related stocks to, you know, gradually start to perform again.
And of course, we've got the national election coming up in about 2 months. Ken, do you think elections generally are red flags to investors to stay away in the meantime amid the uncertainties? Do you think the market plays favorites? Because there was a survey that came out recently showing investors have a preference for a Robredo win. She's our VP today, but a very distant second to Mr. Marcos in local surveys.
Yeah, I mean, the fact is that it's very hard to sometimes dictate, you know, sort of some of the political, you know, sort of impacts as to what's going on there. But I think right now, investors, in particular overseas investors, they're much more, you know, specific and focused on, you know, sort of when the economy is actually going to be sort of reopened, when there's going to be sort of more flow in terms of mobility within the Philippines. I think, you know, for investors, especially overseas investors, they're going to be much more concerned about that. And, you know, whoever does get elected, you know, hopefully, you know, their specific policies will be a full goal as to specifically how quickly we can see the Philippines, you know, sort of really reopen. And I think that's going to be really key for investors when it comes to, you know, how much confidence that they have investing in the Philippine stock market.
All right. On that note, Ken, thank you so much for joining our call. Keep safe.